Welcome back to RICO Busters.
Another judge in Wayne County that the Attorney General is doing nothing about.
Sir, we need to keep this focused on the bill at hand.
Yes, sir, I am.
I don't think so.
I was sitting passively, as all these people are doing behind me, watching the proceedings of a court as a mere observer in the Redford Township, 17th District Court, with Judge Karen Khalil presiding. I was doing nothing except sitting silently and watching the proceedings. The judge created chaos in the courtroom for some unknown reason.
Sir, for the third time, you are not talking about the bill before us. This bill, you're talking about something completely unrelated relating to the conduct in courts in Michigan.
That's correct.
The bill before us
that
is Senate Bill 191.
That leads to a criminal conviction.
Well, then get to it.
When I was sitting doing nothing, I was ordered to stand up by the bailiffs. Apparently, the bailiffs were taking an order from the judge. I was handcuffed. I was taken to a cell. And I was subsequently taken out by the Redford police and taken to the Midland County Jail on a trumped-up 30-day sentence of conviction, summarily convicted of contempt of court, criminal contempt of court. This bill, to get to your issue, sir, does not address the conditions that lead to what can be conceived as a criminal conviction and the circumstances under which, particularly in Wayne County, these judges, as well as other government officials, are operating under the nose of the Michigan Attorney General without any oversight and the abuse of its discretion, and in my circumstance, not even jurisdiction over me as a member of the public sitting in the courtroom.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Next wishing to speak in opposition to the bill is Bruce Timmons.
On May 19, 2015, the House Judiciary Committee of the Michigan Legislature met to discuss a bill proposed by a Michigan senator designed to provide more money to law enforcement to come out of the pockets of persons convicted of contempt of court or found guilty of retail fraud. I happened to be there, and seeing the opportunity to address the issue in the context of first-hand experience, I requested 5 minutes for delivery of my unrehearsed testimony. What follows is from the video archive of the House Judiciary Committee meeting that I attended, and in which the seated chair of that meeting was a man by the name of Kurt Heiss, a Republican representing District 20. District 20 just happens to reside in a suburb of Wayne County, covering Northville, Northville Township, the city of Plymouth, Plymouth Township, and eastern Canton, where wealthy people are known to live, some being judges employed at the corrupt Wayne County Circuit Court, which I was just beginning to reference when Representative Heiss cut me off. This video delivers what Heiss refused to allow me to deliver in a clearly public hearing where the public's response is both warranted and invited. Apparently, only under condition that the public limit their right to free speech to only what the legislature wants to hear, or keep covered up from the public hearing when it comes to the counties they represent. Interestingly, Heiss's peers on the Judiciary Committee also declined to look further into this first-hand report of tyranny in the Michigan judiciary, despite that constitutional checks and balances command the legislature to hold judicial officials accountable, criminally if necessary, for such corrupt patterns and practices as I testified about on their public record.
Wishing to speak in opposition to the bill, David Schied. I get that right?
You did.
All right.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. My name is David Schied. I'm here to speak against this bill for a couple of reasons. I'm a credentialed Michigan school teacher, and I think that what needs to be considered here is what happens to result in a conviction. I don't know anything about accounting. I don't know anything about what's going on at the police station with regard to this or at the retail level. But what I do know is what goes on in the court and what and I'd like to share with you. I originally had come here just as a supporter for Mr. Runstad. I just noticed what was on the agenda, and I filled out one of these cards because this is a significant matter to me. What does the conviction look like from a judge? We have a lot of problems in Wayne County. This is a Senate bill, and you've got a senator that has just made the news recently for going after his wife with a shotgun here in Michigan, and he's from Wayne County by the name of Virgil Smith. Virgil Smith has a father in Wayne County, used to be the chief judge of Wayne County by the name of Virgil Smith, who I have been going after for quite some time with the Attorney General.
Sir, we need to keep it focused on the bill.
I am.
Sure. Let's get off a topic ignored by the legislature for decades, one so pressing and out of control that even every Michigan Attorney General in office ignores: high crimes and misdemeanors committed by Michigan judges and the cover-up by the legislature and executive branches. Isn't it much easier to simply legislate new bills to further oppress average people, such as this one compelling people convicted by corrupt judges of contempt to then have to pay for their own prosecution or face further criminal proceedings for failure to comply with the law? Here we have a Michigan legislator charged with a crime in a county where his father had long been the chief judge for that county. That father, Virgil Smith, originally in his government career, came from the legislature. He then moved through the revolving door to become a prosecutor for Wayne County. This criminal's father has cornered the entire government market in all three branches. Notably, this is not the first time Junior has gotten in trouble with the law. What are the odds, though, that the chief judge's son will actually see a trial by jury, when plea bargaining by his own peers of the State Bar of Michigan can otherwise ensure that the criminal proceedings draw out long enough that the public and the mainstream media forgets about all this? Compare that to the average guy living in the urban war zone of Detroit. Say, the guy who violates a politically motivated judgment order from a judge that is inclined to accept favors or money under the table for such rulings. That person gets quickly slapped with a criminal contempt of court charge. How about the guy, or the average woman, that tells the judge frankly what they really think of Michigan's government and the judicial system in particular?
Sir, we need to keep it focused on the bill.
I am. Another judge in Wayne County that the Attorney General is doing nothing about.
Sir, we need to keep this focused on the bill at hand.
Yes, sir, I am.
I don't think so.
Oh, you don't think so, do you, Kurt? Heiss? Well, ignorance truly is bliss, isn't it, Representative Heiss? And as it's compounded by your peer group of other Michigan legislators of the House Judiciary Committee. Well, let me show you how all of this relates to the toilet paper or bill now before all of you.
I was sitting passively, as all these people are doing behind me, watching the proceedings of a court as a mere observer in the Redford Township, 17th District Court, with Judge Karen Khalil presiding. I was doing nothing except sitting silently and watching the proceedings. The judge created chaos in the courtroom for some unknown reason.
Sir, for the third time, you are not talking about the bill before us. This bill, you're talking about something completely unrelated relating to the conduct in courts in Michigan.
That's correct.
The bill before us
that
is Senate
leads
Bill
to
191.
A criminal conviction.
Well, then get to it.
When I was sitting doing nothing, I was ordered to stand up by the bailiffs. Apparently, the bailiffs were taking an order from the judge. I was handcuffed. I was taken to a cell. And I was subsequently taken out by the Redford police and taken to the Midland County Jail on a trumped-up 30-day sentence of conviction, summarily convicted of contempt of court, criminal contempt of court. This bill, to get to your issue, sir, does not address the conditions that lead to what can be conceived as a criminal conviction and the circumstances under which, particularly in Wayne County, these judges, as well as other government officials, are operating under the nose of the Michigan Attorney General without any oversight and the abuse of its discretion, and in my circumstance, not even jurisdiction over me as a member of the public sitting in the courtroom.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Next wishing to speak in opposition to the bill is...
Hold the bus. Thank you. I'm not finished yet. I'm going to tell you more about this situation in Wayne County, whether you want to hear it or not. You see, according to the Michigan Secretary of State in the executive branch of Michigan government, for literally all of his time as the chief judge of the entire Wayne County Circuit Court of around 59 corrupt judges of the county, Virgil Smith had no oath of office or a sworn allegiance to either the Constitution of the State of Michigan or to the United States. Go figure on how this could have continued for this long a time while Virgil Smith was convicting people of the community, taking away their homes through illegal foreclosures and evictions, and all the while refusing to succumb to my demands for a criminal grand jury investigation of the county corruption and government racketeering. Representative Heiss, if you had not shut me up, I would have told you exactly how this could go on, even despite clear written notice to the Michigan Attorney General Bill Schuette months before the November 2012 elections, and by a group of concerned law-abiding tax-paying Wayne County citizens. Here is the document, notarized, and not only sent to the Republican Attorney General, but also to the Republican Governor Rick Snyder, who both completely ignored it three times in follow-up, allowing Virgil Smith to be on the ballot as the so-called incumbent when he was knowingly nothing but a usurper of judicial government power. While ignoring these citizen reports of criminal racketeering activities of the Wayne County Judiciary, Attorney General Bill Schuette also ignored clear notice in 2012 of a more localized government racketeering ring going on at the 17th District Court of Redford Township in Wayne County. Such notice was conferred through a man by the name of Robbie Ranke, who was then the public liaison for the Michigan Secretary of State, Republican Ruth Johnson. Here's a letter sent from Robbie Ranke to me, David Schied, dated August 9, 2011. The letter is informing me that after talking with the Secretary of State's legal staff about the evidence that I had previously sent to the Secretary of State's office, evidence that I will present again to you momentarily, the Secretary of State and her legal staff decided it best to ignore my pleas for a grand jury investigation to be requested by that office. Instead, Robbie Ranke was instructed by his supervisors to send my evidence to the highly corrupted office of the Michigan Attorney General, in the care of one of Bill Schuette's most corrupt political assistants, Richard Cunningham. This is someone with whom I had a previous run-in just a few months prior to that while attempting to sue the judges of the 17th District Court in the Redford Township Police Department for their racketeering and corruption. Before I present the underlying evidence giving reason for my suit against the Redford Township Police Department, the Redford Township Supervisor, and the two judges of the 17th District Court, let's jump into what Richard Cunningham and the others working for the illustrious Michigan Attorney General Bill Schuette did with my complaint to their office about such racketeering and corruption going on in Wayne County. I wish to premise this with the Attorney General Bill Schuette's formal oath of office, as held by the Secretary of State's office. Notice that Schuette has pledged his support of the constitutions of Michigan and the United States, and faithfully discharging his duties of office. So what exactly are those duties of office? The Michigan compiled laws makes clear that the Attorney General is to be acting on behalf of the people of this state, not the state, on matters of interest to the people, not the state. In 1974, there appeared further clarification that when it came to the people of Michigan as consumers, the Attorney General is not getting paid $112,000 a year to give advice to the government as his client. He's got the solemn responsibility of conscious and legal obligation to act in the interest of the people of Michigan, not the government of Michigan. This means the Attorney General has no business defending local or statewide government corruption, and in fact, means that the Attorney General has every duty to properly investigate and prosecute reports of government racketeering and corruption, not covering it up. Bear in mind that as assistants to the Attorney General, any state bar attorney employed by the Attorney General is liable to the public for these same duties, each having subscribed to a similar oath for their public office, to honor our constitutional guarantees and the legislator's statutory mandates upon government officials. Yet here's the reply to the materials sent to the Attorney General's office by the Secretary of State's office, which were sent by Robbie Ranke along with the Secretary of State's request for the Attorney General to investigate a citizen's report about corruption and racketeering activities being carried out by the judges and the police in Wayne County, Michigan's Redford Township. Richard Cunningham, a former Wayne County prosecutor, stated on behalf of Attorney General Bill Schuette, a former Michigan Court of Appeals judge, that he had carefully reviewed my materials, which were sent to him by Robbie Ranke on behalf of the Secretary of State. Noting that he failed to otherwise investigate this matter, Cunningham somehow concluded that my complaint about the corruption at the 17th District Court, about the Redford Township Police Department, and about the township itself under the leadership of the supervisor Tracy Kobelarth, were incredibly frivolous and totally without merit. He stated, officially, to the Michigan Department of State that the Michigan Department of Attorney General sees, quote, absolutely no basis for any criminal prosecution of these public officials, unquote, because, quote, there simply isn't evidence of an organized conspiracy between the police and the court to defraud the public, unquote. Again, I say, oh, really? Bear in mind that my initial complaint to Robbie Ranke stated that the Redford Police Department is issuing traffic citations after which the 17th District Court clerks, employed by the Redford Township, sent out fraudulent notices of appearance telling the public that they should be prepared to argue their case before a magistrate, and that subsequently, when people arrive to the court, they are met by an empty bench and the police officer who wrote the ticket operating out of the DA's office, dressed in plain clothes, impersonating a prosecuting attorney, a judicial officer, and practicing law without a state license. Essentially, I had reported that the police officer writing the tickets was calling community citizens, who otherwise were responding to the 17th District Court's notice of appearance, into the DA's office and using pressure and threats to extort a guilty plea and money from them to keep them from having more points on their driving records and higher costs on their auto insurance. Significantly, the first thing I sent to Robbie Ranke to let him know that I was serious in claiming that this notice to appear was fraudulent on its face was by the fact that it misled me to believe that I should be prepared to be sentenced by a magistrate of the court, authorized to practice law by a state bar number of P0444. Without getting into the details of my argument with the imposter police officer impersonating as the court's district attorney, I went home that day and looked up that state bar number of P0444 to find no such number actually existed. Contrary to Cunningham's later claim to Ranky as the government agent for the Secretary of State, this fraudulence had significant merit. You see, I was relying upon due process being provided to me by this court. I had even been assured of it beforehand by the Redford Township Police supervisor of the officer that wrote me the ticket, a man with the last name I knew to be Greg, whose first name I only found out long afterwards to be Dwayne. The fact is that I found that Redford officer Greg to be a real jerk the night before I telephoned the police station to speak to the police chief about the conduct of Officer Greg at the time he pulled me over. When I called the Redford police station to make my complaint on the officer, however, I ended up with an even bigger jerk, Officer Bensie, answering the phone lines. When I asked simply for the first names of the police chief and the officer's supervisor for submitting my written complaint, the answering officer refused. Instead, he insisted sarcastically that the police chief's first name was Chief and the supervisor's first name was Captain. Hence, my complaint letter started with Chief Chief and Captain Captain. Nevertheless, I got a written answer to that complaint about Redford Township Officer Dwayne Gregg. Not surprisingly, Greg's supervisor, James Foldy, found no violations of the Redford Township's policy on how private individuals should be treated in public by the officers. Significantly, however, he wrote that whatever problem I had with the officer's issuance of the ticket I received, I could find my due process remedy with the court. The court in which the officer that wrote the ticket, Dwayne Gregg, was the only person present, in plain clothes, impersonating a licensed prosecuting attorney, extorting money from the private individuals responding to notices of appearance, and threatening me judicially with contempt of court if I did not succumb to his threats, and while denying me the right to file a cross-complaint against him as the officer. This guy had crossed the line in so many ways. By the unauthorized practice of law, by impersonating a judicial officer, and with the contempt of court threat being something that only an authorized judge or magistrate might lawfully do under totally different circumstances. It was when the police officer Greg told me I would not be filing any cross-complaint in the 17th District Court about the officer, him, that wrote me the ticket, and afterwards when the corporate township supervisor, Tracy Kobelarth, failed to answer my letter of complaint to her about these matters, that I right away filed my written complaint with the higher Wayne County Circuit Court, alleging that all these police officers, the township supervisor, and the judges of the 17th District Court are all engaging in racketeering operation. There was much more than the due process denial of not allowing me to file a complaint against the officer writing the ticket, and extorting money from me and many others under threat of having to come back to the court again on a different day, with a stiffer penalty virtually guaranteed with the judge, and higher insurance costs in consequence for all those not taking the police officer's offer. And all that after first issuing a fraudulent notice of appearance through the mail to people stating that they should be prepared to see a magistrate with the bar number of P0444. The 17th District Court, led by Judge Karen Khalil, went further to defraud the Michigan Secretary of State by having my driver's license suspended and subsequently changing the civil ordinance charge to a criminal misdemeanor and issuing an arrest warrant against me. Without getting into the details, it should suffice to say that this fraud upon Ruth Johnson's office occurred after I had sent my money into the court in good faith, along with other documents in challenge of the ticket, and after this judicial usurper Karen Khalil had also clearly issued this fraudulent show cause order by color of law and based upon an invalid show cause motion built right into that fraudulent order. So you may ask yourself, Kurt Heiss, what makes this motion and order signed by this so-called judge, Karen Khalil, so fraudulent? I'm glad you asked. As with so many government operations, it's hidden in plain sight, right at the bottom of the document signed by this judge. You see, these references to Michigan compiled laws and or to Michigan court rules are supposed to present clear authority for government to do what it does. The problem that has too long plagued our society, however, is that the judiciary knows that most everyone is too lazy to look up and analyze these references against what the government actually is doing. Government instead refers the public to lawyers who, although they know clearly what is going on, don't say anything to the judges that could cause them to risk either the chance of their winning their case or the risk of their career, since lawyers know they will be back to any particular judge again at some point in their career. So here we have the reference to MCR 3.606A of Michigan Court Rules, which governs how cases against people minding their own business and living out their right to peaceful enjoyment of life, liberty, and property can be deprived of such rights through due process, as is otherwise required under the state and federal constitutions. As this court rule commands, it begins with an ex parte motion, which is essentially initiated by one party being threatened by another party, with the threatened party requesting judicial relief outside the presence of the so-called offending party. Note that this form document of motion and order signed by this so-called judge, Khalil, begins near the top with the captioning of motion and affidavit. This is for good reason. By reference to MCR 3.606A, the motion must be supported by an affidavit. In other words, it is not enough for someone to simply accuse someone of doing something. Their statement must be sworn to and verified for authenticity by a state-certified notary public who can vouch that the person making the claim is indeed that person. That person making such accusations must also be willing to later testify to their statements if they want the court to act in some way now. This is because the due process rights of every accused person includes the right to face and question the person or persons making such accusations against them. With that information attested to under sworn oath and penalty of perjury, a judge thus has probable cause to act in some way, under strict due process guidelines to assure the doctrine of innocent until proven guilty. So to begin proceedings on the deprivation of the accused person of their peaceful enjoyment of life, liberty, and property. In the case of show cause hearings, if the accused person fails to show up to the hearing, the judge then has warranted justification for applying penalties against the person accused of the wrongdoing. That process usually begins in the form of a warrant for their arrest. So in theory, the form of this document is correct. It presents a motion by an individual whose personal interest in the matter is supposed to be conveyed in this first line, which was left blank but filled in by a red stamp to make this gross omissions of substantial fact look somehow official. This alone is enough for any judge to throw out the motion. Next, the request to have me hauled into court for failure to pay fines is by affidavit of what appears to be yet another stamp, being a cloned signature of someone named Donna, with a last name that is anyone's guess. Significantly, the area below for the notary to verify the above as sworn statements and validating the identity of the person signing is left completely blank. Again, this is cause for any valid judge to throw out this document for failure to properly identify the accuser and secure the state's rights to violate another citizen's rights to peaceful enjoyment. For Karen Khalil to move forward in setting up a show cause hearing and commanding me to place myself before her at her mercy constitutes action taken under color of law, which is a federal crime. See 18 U.S.C. section 242. For Khalil to act in this way, particularly in a systemic pattern and practice of day-to-day operation of the court, using these stamps in such way with the clerks on the Redford Township payroll and with the Redford Township as the plaintiff in this matter, constitutes a criminal conspiracy as defined by 18 U.S.C. section 241. Without a doubt, these actions served to bolster the credibility of my higher Wayne County, Michigan, Third Circuit Court complaint about racketeering and corruption, which was then before another so-called judge named Robert Colombo, who, by the way, is the current chief judge of Wayne County Circuit Court, having taken over after Virgil Smith was taken out. Likely due to the stink that I was making of all this mess in 2010 through 2012. So why might you try to stymie my testimony and shut me down on this matter, Kurt Heiss? And why might none of the rest of you challenge your criminal justice committee peer to hear out significant personal testimony about such corruption at an official legislative hearing being televised by closed circuit cameras around the room? Might I guess that the Michigan legislature did not want to hear about the conduct of judges by which constitutionally mandated checks and balances would require all of you to take action to have this judge removed and to order a grand jury investigation into a conspiracy of actions between the police, the clerks, and judges not only at the Redford Township, but also at the Wayne County Circuit Court level, where my case, my allegations of criminal racketeering, and my demand for criminal grand jury investigation were all eventually thrown out by what is now known as the current chief of that Wayne County Circuit Court, Robert Colombo. Is it the fact that the possibility of the death penalty being applied to a judge and her conspirators scaring you too much in the legislature, where the unconstitutionality of your actions may also be called into question? And where other acts of treason against the state and the United States Constitution, against the laws and the legislative rules, and against the rights of we the people are taking place? Does prison for government officials and the death penalty scare you, Representative Heiss, being so closely tied to what is actually going on in Wayne County government racketeering and the aiding and abetting by the executive branch of all these judicial crimes, being at the state level by the Michigan Attorney General Bill Schuette and the Governor Rick Snyder?
Sir, we need to keep it focused on the bill.
I am. Another judge in Wayne County that the Attorney General is doing nothing about.
Sir, we need to keep this focused on the bill at hand.
Yes, sir, I am.
I don't think so.
Was this not extortion and racketeering, Mr. Heiss? Take a look at the register of action for that 2010-2011 speeding ticket case. The initial speeding ticket, if left unchallenged, was $175 alone. When the Wayne County Circuit Court Judge Robert Colombo refused to allow me to remove that ticket to his court when I attempted to file my cross complaint that was denied to me by the local Redford Township Court, by the police officer that wrote the ticket, as I had attempted to file it against the police officer that wrote the ticket to me, the cost of the ticket went up to $352, when including all of the various penalties and fees. By the time Khalil issued her unlawful bench warrant, she was demanding that I paid $412 to keep police from jailing me at will, which I eventually paid. However, that is another significant matter related to this case. You might say it's the icing on this cake, all manufactured by a corporate government enterprise engaging in criminal racketeering. Let me explain. Oh, I know you don't want me to, Kurt, but now I've got the control of my own free speech, and you are not at liberty to shut me up. There was a reason for my focusing not only on the judicial conduct that is far out of control in Wayne County, but also on the Attorney General's refusal to do anything about it. Remember the materials that Robbie Ranke sent to Richard Cunningham, the Attorney General's Criminal Division Chief stationed in Detroit, right in the middle of all this corruption? Well, I'm going to show you what this wolf in sheep's clothing sent both openly to me and in secret to his colleagues in the executive branch at the state capitol in Lansing. The devil truly is in the details, being details that you, Kurt Heiss, damn sure did not want to have exposed by me as a matter of official record at a legislative hearing, did you, Heiss? The date was September 29, 2011, when Cunningham drafted for me the evidence of his criminal cover-ups of the crimes that I was reporting to the Michigan Secretary of State, Ruth Johnson, as sent to him by Robbie Ranke. Cunningham did a great job summarizing the gist of what I provided in statements and evidence to Robbie Ranke and Ruth Johnson. I was denied due process by both the police and the court operating in Redford Township. He acknowledged that I was reporting myself to be a crime victim, and such victimization was caused by public officials running corrupt organizations and racketeering operations in Wayne County. So I guess that we can state that any action taken by Cunningham from this point forward is done with clear knowledge and intent to deprive me of my right to honest government services and my right to government security and protection. I will skip paragraph 2 and most of paragraph 3 because these two paragraphs are entirely rhetorical and consist of Cunningham's own interpretation of the evidence forwarded to him by the Secretary of State. Significantly, however, Cunningham made reference to a motion to set aside the default judgment that I had sent in to the 17th District Court along with my payment to the court upon being sent the fraudulent motion and order for my appearance at a show cause hearing. Importantly, near the top of that fraudulent show cause document is a notice stating that if I pay the extortion amount in full before the court date, there is no need for me to make the appearance in that court and before that judge, Khalil. Understandably, having witnessed so much corruption in Redford, in Wayne County, and more recently by the Wayne County Circuit Court Judge Robert Colombo, and the law firm defending the Redford Township against my criminal allegations, which was doing just like Cunningham did by ignoring the obvious evidence and justifying their clients' actions based on mere color of law, I was petrified at the thought of placing myself into the jurisdiction of that court and before that judge. Therefore, I sent in the full payment ahead of time, and while also taking the suggestion of a friendly lawyer who was aware of the egregiousness of this matter, by sending that payment along with a motion for this Judge Khalil to set aside the previous default judgment against me and to hold a rehearing so that I could speak directly on the record about the basis for my own actions and challenge the speeding ticket. The thing is, when I presented the register of actions a few minutes ago, did you happen to see anywhere that the clerks actually registered the motion referenced by Cunningham's letter? Let's look again. Here is the motion to set aside default judgment. Note that it included my affidavited facts to support my own criminal allegations against those victimizing me. Note that my cover page, dated July 25, 2011, also points out that my previous reports to self-policing government officials about the racketeering remain unresolved, which is still the case today, 4 years later, and with everyone and their mother in government knowing about my criminal allegations and demands for a grand jury investigation by the people instead of this useless and crooked self-policing government. Note that in addition to that July 25, 2011 motion, I also sent another filing to the 17th District Court in response to the fraudulent motion and order sent to me by the clerks of the court, who were then also committing felony mail fraud by sending me that document. So who do you go to besides RICO busters when the government fails their obligations to regulate, police, investigate, and prosecute themselves? The name of this second filing, sent about a month and a half later and dated on September 12, 2011, was captioned Response to Fraudulent Order to Show Cause of Judge Karen Khalil, predicated upon a fraudulent motion to show cause completed by an unknown and unidentified party. This filing, which was sent by certified mail along with my full payment of $312, was combined with my own motion for Judge Karen Khalil to disqualify herself based on her abuse of judicial discretion and her own criminal misconduct, which I conveniently spelled out as a felony conspiracy to deprive of rights and felony extortion. Now, what is so darn interesting about this official record of the 17th District Court is the fact that, as shown by the grayed areas I have marked at about the dated periods of July 25th and September 11th, there is no sign whatsoever of either of my motions being entered into the 17th District Court record. This is no mistake. This was clear fraud upon the court. How can I prove it? Why, Kurt Heiss, I thought you'd never ask. Now, pay attention, Kurt, because what I'm about to show you proves that with a corrupt judiciary, no amount of good faith diligence and anal retentiveness in record keeping can overcome the government's criminal intent to deprive people of their rights to due process. Here, I have gone so far out of the way to think ahead about what the judges and clerks of this 17th District Court can and might do wrong that it will befuddle your mind. I have been acting on the premise that when given every chance to do wrong, these government functionaries will do wrong, to whitewash over any and all evidence of their racketeering schemes. So hold on to your seat, Kurt, and keep that head propped up, because I am holding you just as personally accountable as these other criminals of the Attorney General Bill Schuette and his assistant Richard Cunningham, and the Wayne County Circuit Court Chief Judges Virgil Smith and Robert Colombo. Now that all of you and your peers of the Michigan Legislature Judicial Committee know about this. Remember, Title 18, Section 4 of the United States Code maintains that anyone in government that has the knowledge of the actual commission of a felony, say such as racketeering and corruption, and who does not make it known to some other person with the authority to do something about this, shall be fined or imprisoned for up to 3 years or both. I have the evidence Bill Schuette and his predecessor, Mike Cox, and each of their assistant attorney generals, being all members of the State Bar of Michigan, along with the two recent chief judges of the Wayne County Circuit Court, the Michigan Court of Appeals, and even the Supreme Court, who are all also members of that same state bar of attorneys, are fully aware of what these government usurpers of Karen Khalil, the Redford Township Police, and the Redford Township Supervisor are all doing to perpetuate these crimes upon the citizens of their local community by treason against the United States and actions committed under color of law. So tell me, Kurt, are you going to be wearing a white hat or a black one? Might you like to trade in that dark business suit for an orange jumpsuit like the one I was forced to wear? Is all you have to say is thank you at learning that I had merely been sitting peaceably in the courtroom audience with my notepad auditing the government that my taxpayer dollars are supporting when I was suddenly and forcibly kidnapped from a courtroom and falsely imprisoned for exercising my own patriotic duty to hold government criminals accountable? How about it, Kurt Heiss? What are you going to do to ensure that my new prison record, the fraudulent 17th District Court docketing records, and the records of immunity for this judicial imposter, Karen Khalil, actually gets fixed? The fact is, that friendly attorney I mentioned who suggested that I send my payment in with that motion to set aside default judgment had a secretary more than willing on September 12th to mail my documents to the 17th District Court for me, along with my cover letter to Karen Khalil, just as she had been doing regularly for her boss. Also in that envelope was my subpoena to Karen Khalil, which pertained to the Wayne County Circuit Court case, which was at that time being dismembered and discarded by Judge Robert Colombo, all in front of numerous other concerned citizens and taxpayers attending court proceedings as court watchers. The subpoena, also dated September 12, 2011, was requesting, quote, all records, documents, transcripts, audio and video recordings, witness statements, radar reports, police reports, court docketing sheets, defendant sign-in sheets, and all other items that I had earlier requested during the higher court proceedings. These were all documents that the Redford Township attorney, Jeffrey Clark, that was refusing to provide back to me, along with the answers that I had demanded under discovery in the form of interrogatory questions. 3 days after mailing my payment and correspondence, on September 15, 2011, Sandy Hanks, the secretary for the kindly lawyer who sympathized with my situation, attested to the delivery of those items to Karen Khalil, formally signing a document called a proof of service before her boss, who, being a lawyer and officer of the court, had notarized Ms. Hanks' signature on that legal document of evidence. The returned mailing receipt showed that someone named something like Donette Paul had signed for the receipt of all those items on September 13, 2011, 3 days prior to the date on which Judge Khalil's fraudulent show cause motion commanded me to pay the extortion amount of $312 beforehand, or else have to show up to the scheduled court date of September 16, 2011. With that proof of service in hand, I next telephoned the 17th District Court with Sandy Hanks listening silently on another line at her boss's office. Answering the phone at the clerk's office for the 17th District Court was someone identifying herself as Mrs. Paul. As this sworn and notarized affidavit of Sandy Hanks clearly states, Mrs. Paul stated that her position with the 17th District Court was that of a court clerk. She heard Mrs. Paul state that according to the records she accessed, there was a show cause hearing on September 16, 2011, and Judge Khalil issued an arrest warrant for me, David Schied. Sandy Hanks' sworn and notarized witness affidavit also stated that she heard me on the phone saying that such a hearing should not have been held since the condition of the court was that if I had made payment before the show cause hearing, that I would not need to show up, and that if I had the proof of delivery in my hand showing that my payment was received by the court long before the scheduled court hearing, Mrs. Hanks additionally verified that this Redford Township court clerk indicated that she could provide no further help in the matter, but only suggested that I should come in to settle the issue. Right. I was born, but not yesterday, and I recognize an unlawful entrapment when I see it. As Sandy Hanks' written testimony continues, I telephoned the court a second time right afterwards, again with Mrs. Hanks listening silently on another phone extension. As Ms. Hanks attested, Mrs. Paul was again the person answering that call, and the first thing I did was confirm that Mrs. Paul's first name was indeed Donette. Then, confronting her with the fact that she had been the one to sign for my package with the $312 money order payment to the court, she admitted over the phone that she had indeed signed for the delivery. Though she first wished to reject responsibility for knowing what became of the package that was not addressed to her but instead to the Judge Karen Khalil, upon my first implying that interference with the U.S. mail charges may soon follow against Mrs. Paul, she then stated without hesitation that she remembered having personally delivered that package directly to Judge Khalil the very same day she had received and signed for it. Again, this is information for which I have ample additional proof that the Assistant Attorney General Richard Cunningham, the Michigan Secretary of State Ruth Johnson, and Wayne County Circuit Court Judge Robert Colombo, the judges of the Michigan Court of Appeals, the Michigan Supreme Court, and the Judicial Tenure Commission all tried to sweep under the government corruption and racketeering rug. To be candid, the entire Michigan government system in place is so thoroughly corrupt, it is sickening. It truly is treason, and I see that the State Bar of Michigan has instituted a statewide revolution against the Constitution of the state and the United States. And as the Declaration of Independence asserted long ago, the time has come to abolish and replace it. Every bit of it. But again, This is my personal opinion, and I know that you, Kurt, are not a bit interested in that, are you?
You're talking about something completely unrelated relating to the conduct in courts in Michigan.
That's correct.
The bill before us
that
is Senate
leads
Bill
to
191.
A criminal conviction.
Well, then get to it.
I suspect that it will take a while to convince people like you, Kurt. And perhaps it will start by putting one or two people at a time behind bars. If we're diligent, however, perhaps the FBI will step away from its investigating and harassing those like us who are openly reacting to this treason and finally do a job of dropping the hammer on the entire operation as it did in the 1980s in Cook County near Chicago with the infamous Graylord cases. This was where 92 people were indicted, including 17 judges, 48 lawyers, 10 deputy sheriffs, 8 policemen, 8 court officials, and a state legislator. How does that sound, Kurt Heiss?
If any of you like to get angry, I can tell you that what I'm going to say is going to get you very, very, very angry. These people take outrageous, disgusting human behavior to previously unimaginable heights. How evil, how perverse, how sick, how criminal. Can anything possibly be more abominable? Because it... Whoever willfully causes an act to be done, which, if directly performed by him, would be a crime, is punishable as a principle. That's federal law. How could this possibly happen in the United States of America?
I don't have to tell you that we're living in a very hostile, extremely incendiary world. Now's the time, perhaps more than ever before, for America to show the world its leadership in democracy, morality, and the rule of law.
All I need is a grand jury in some little town in America, and all of a sudden things are going to change very quickly. Take my word for that.
So with enough information provided in this video to show that the Redford Township Police, city supervisor, and at least one of the two judges of the 17th District Court, along with their on-call defense attorney, are all engaging in numerous crimes of racketeering combined with a criminal protection racket by the judges, prosecutors, and lawyers operating in and around Wayne County's 3rd Judicial Circuit Court, it's time to put the focus again at the state level. Exactly what role does the Michigan Attorney General and his entourage of assistants have in the statewide cover-up of local and county crime being reported all over the state by people just like me? Knowing the extent to which I was aware that both Bill Schuette and his predecessor Mike Cox had quashed all of my efforts to get the Attorney General's office to intervene in the corruption that was affecting my career, my livelihood, my marriage and family, and what I knew had to be also happening across the state against the constitutionally guaranteed freedoms of other people across Michigan, my FOIA request asked for documents that identified all existing cases of public integrity or corruption in its many forms, such as by errors and omissions, gross negligence, dereliction, official malfeasance, etc., in which the Attorney General or his agents had denied or dismissed or closed the case. I wanted to see cases like my own numerous court cases against the corrupt government of the state of Michigan, cases in which the Attorney Generals Bill Schuette and Mike Cox claimed that my allegations against their peers of government officials did not rise to the level that warrants investigation. Getting into the specifics of my numerous requests for documents were those letters of complaints received from other citizens and taxpayers of the state that were addressed to or assigned to Richard Cunningham, to the Criminal Division or the Public Integrity Unit over which Cunningham was in charge, or addressed to the new crime victim's advocate hired by Schuette that simply washed his hands on my written complaint of being a crime victim of multi-departmental government corruption. Apparently, even the Attorney General's internal communications serve as a reminder to our state functionary that they really are not a government, but instead a company, for which no bonds were ever found or produced in answer to my FOIA request to all of these various departments and agencies of the corporate state of Michigan. In fact, I got very few documents back from all of these agencies, a sure sign that they are collectively covering something up and with the Attorney General holding the bag on the goods that I wanted. If I would only pay for its extortion amount of $8,896.91, beginning with an immediate deposit of $4,448.45. Now, where is a government crime victim going to get that kind of money to pay its perpetrators for the documents that will otherwise convict virtually all of the judiciary and the executive branch of the so-called state of Michigan, from the top down? Notably, there were a few enclosures that were provided to me for free by this initial response to my FOIA request to the Attorney General, which did catch my attention. For instance, in this company hot print, there was the reminder that during my 2011 divorce proceeding, I had been demanding that the divorce court judge or friend of the court initiate grand jury proceedings to investigate my allegations that my divorce was the direct result of an out-of-control Michigan government. This Wayne County Court document was eventually filed on appeal of Wayne County's denial of my request for grand jury investigation. It was officially stamped by both the Michigan Supreme Court and the state court administrator, which, after the Michigan Court of Appeals denied my demand for criminal grand jury investigation, both also declined in any way to address my claims throughout my divorce that government officials had libelously and slanderously discredited me for the previous 8 years, to such extent that my reputation and career as a full-time public school teacher were destroyed, and I no longer was able to financially, emotionally, and otherwise support both my learning disabled wife and dependent child. Also during these divorce proceedings, I had sent out similar subpoenas to the corrupt government officials that had taken part in this destruction of my family unit, many being sent to the Wayne County government officials, and one being sent to the Michigan Attorney General. Richard Cunningham apparently was the one to eventually handle that matter. Here is Cunningham's version of how he handled the quashing of my efforts to hold local and state government imposters accountable. It is in the form of an internal memo, apparently to another agent of the Attorney General, Bill Schuette. Here, Cunningham took issue with the fact that I, as a pro se litigant handling my own divorce case against my wife's state bar attorney, used the only subpoena forms available to me in my legal dealings, which were, by design, unfairly biased in favor of parties with attorneys. Bear in mind that about this time I was also dealing with all kinds of mass opposition and cover-up to my endeavors by the clerks and judges of the Wayne County Circuit Court all the way through the Michigan Court of Appeals to the Michigan Supreme Court. With the courts intentionally placing anyone without an attorney at a great legal disadvantage, people like me handling their own cases, who have no attorney available to sign the subpoena themselves and facing judges who would rather dismiss my cases before providing me with the means to conduct properly legal discovery in order to win them. Now contrast Cunningham's letter to his co-worker to my letter dated May 19, 2011. To the letter I had written to Cunningham almost 2 weeks earlier on May 6, 2011. Which was right after I had hung up the phone from that phone call. My aim was to memorialize the phone conversation about that subpoena to the Attorney General, Schuette. Compared to Cunningham's official documentation, my letter gets more into the actual details of what transpired with this government functionary, and for good reason. The letter offered the reminder that this phone discussion was not the first meeting in which I found such resistance from Cunningham. Just 3 to 4 weeks prior to my sending out the subpoena, I had delivered a 3-inch criminal complaint to Cunningham's office. This letter served to remind Cunningham that he refused to discuss these documents with me, but only wanted me to drop them off at the department's office lobby table, with nobody of accountability. My letter also made known the fact that when responding with refusal to answer my subpoena, Cunningham also refused to give me, as a state functionary, his job title, the exact location of his office, or his phone number. The letter showed that in reply to Cunningham's implying that by issuing and signing a subpoena myself, I was engaging in the illegal practice of law by impersonating an attorney, I wrote that he, in disregarding his duty to accept my 3-inch stack of documents in support of my racketeering and corruption crime report, and by his also completely disregarding my persistent demands for access to a criminal grand jury for investigating this evidence, Cunningham himself might be the one who is illegally impersonating a law enforcement officer. Moreover, with the clear understanding that the Michigan Attorney General and his assistants indeed have the authority to present state cases to special grand juries convened within the United States District for the Eastern District of Michigan in Detroit, I cited for Cunningham Title 18 of United States Code, which issue a federal mandate for functionaries like him to present my reports of crimes directly to the federal special grand jury. I even went so far in the final paragraph of the letter to reference several more Michigan statutes that also mandates a state criminal investigation of my claims. The fact that Cunningham and others employed by the Michigan Attorney General Bill Schuette disregarded these references to both state and federal code constitutes what I see to be federal felony crimes of obstruction of justice, interference with grand jury proceedings, a misprision of felony, and treason against the laws of the United States of America at minimum. So, Representative Heiss, who or what exactly do you represent? The government or the people? Never mind answering. That's a rhetorical question. Nonetheless, you now have the overview of what has been going on for a long time underneath the bedsheets in Wayne County and throughout the state with your compadres, who are swishing through that revolving door between branches so fast it's long been difficult, just looking at the faces, to determine which branch of government someone is operating. Here in Michigan, without a doubt, there are no checks and balances. It's instead the usurpation of virtually all powers and operations of the state being played out through company policies and the color of law, and destroying the lives, families, property ownership, and prosperity of both the people of this state and the constitutional basis for the government itself. Frankly, I'm offended. I will conclude this speech before the legislature by driving this point home, since I have Bill Schuette's agent of destruction, Assistant Attorney General Richard Cunningham, readily available as a prime example of how your government mischaracterizes and mistreats we the people when we call you public functionaries to the table for accountability. Here's one of those eye-opening documents that the Department of Michigan Attorney General did send back to me at no cost in answering to my FOIA request. It starts with a reference by Beth Nuremberg, an assistant attorney general answering incoming calls from the public. Nuremberg's notation reflects my call to the attorney general looking for someone else that would listen and help about the middle of May 2011. This was precisely when Richard Cunningham was denying my subpoena and fraudulently claiming to Robbie Ranke and the Secretary of State, Ruth Johnson, that he had carefully reviewed my reports about the actions of Karen Khalil in the 17th District Court. As just shown, this was when Cunningham was officially reporting that he had seen nothing wrong with the railroading of a fraudulent set-aside hearing and the burying of my certified mailed-in citation payment, which Khalil and her cohorts did so that they could deprive me of due process while simultaneously streamlining the 17th District Court's unlawful suspension of my driver's license by fraud upon the Secretary of State, and by issuing an arrest warrant against me under the fraudulent claim that I had failed to respond to blatantly unconstitutional actions of that corrupt municipal township and its company of court employees who were engaging in widespread racketeering. Nuremberg had written to Assistant Attorney General Rusty Hill, who I talked with after these internal communications took place. Rusty Hill was someone referred to me directly by a friend, a former University of Michigan aerospace engineering professor who has for the better part of this last decade been blowing the whistle on national security issues related to the Michigan governor, a University of Michigan alumnus, the University of Michigan Board of Regents, and the U of M president Mary Sue Coleman, all freely trading dual-use technology with China that can be used to intercept United States war missiles and annihilate United States satellites and our troops. In any event, this professor, Dr. William Kaufman, though pressured by the university to an early retirement because of his whistleblowing, found some pretense of listening to his complaint by Rusty Hill. And so he thought I might try contacting Hill before I tried contacting any other crooks at the Attorney General's office. Well, you see that instead of simply returning my call based on Dr. Kaufman's referral, Rusty Hill sought to consult with both Richard Cunningham and the former criminal division chief, Thomas Cameron, who I had been reporting statewide corruption to about 5 years prior to that while he was working for the former Michigan Attorney General, Mike Cox. As shown, Cunningham was quick to respond, claiming to be very familiar with me, playing me out to either being certifiably crazy or a domestic terrorist or both, while advising Rusty Hill that if he were to meet with me, that he should greet me with a fully armed platoon of state-trained assassins, likely referring to the phone conversation that I just described pertaining to his refusal to answer my divorce court subpoena for documents. Cunningham also mischaracterized the response shown in my letter as some form of unreasonable rant. As an added courtesy, it appears that Cunningham also copied numerous others to ensure that all others at the Attorney General's office got the same word about me. With my credibility being unknowingly destroyed by Cunningham's fraudulence upon his own peers to further his aiding and abetting of the crimes he was otherwise charged by the Michigan Department of State of investigating and reporting upon, I managed that same day to get Rusty Hill by phone to find him declining altogether to meet with me. I remember during that brief call him asking me, "You mean to report that Michigan's government is corrupt top to bottom?" And when I reported yes, his response was that he could not think of anyone that could help me with that. So there you have it, Legislator Heist. In an hour-long nutshell, the evidence of how top-to-bottom corruption is being carried out here in Michigan and by whom. Oh, by the way, since 2012, an insider to all this criminal corruption, the former Chief Justice of the Michigan Supreme Court, Justice Elizabeth Weaver, has been saying the same thing that I have been saying. From the time she turned in her resignation from the Supreme Court in 2010, through her time in writing and publishing of this book about her experiences as the Chief of Michigan's highest court, and right up until her mysterious death several weeks ago. I know, because she invited me to a day in her home a year ago to talk about all of this. It's been confirmed now from both the grassroots and at the top of the so-called government hierarchy. The state functionaries operate under color of law. The state itself is so thoroughly corrupted that it has long stopped functioning constitutionally for the people. It is a sick, self-perpetuating machine that unlawfully services only its own sustenance. The entire system is broken. Aren't you proud? Or are you too in it to get all you can before getting out? Again, you don't have to answer that. It's rhetorical. Just to let you know where I am with all this now, I just in the last 10 days filed my federal case of criminal kidnapping and false imprisonment in the federal court of the Eastern District of Michigan, residing smack dab in the middle of Detroit, in Wayne County. Guess what? The case was immediately assigned to Sean Cox. That is the brother of the former Michigan Attorney General Mike Cox. Oh, by the way, Sean Cox's sister-in-law, Mike Cox's wife, has for at least this past decade been a Wayne County Commissioner, holding great interest in the purse strings of Wayne County, now under my legal attack. Do you think there might be any conflict of interest going on here from the start? Probably not any more than what I've already pointed out in Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy's refusal to recuse her office from handling the prosecution of the Michigan Senator, Virgil Smith, the son of her longtime compadre, in regard to that most recent over three-time felony charge of Smith going after his wife with nearly 20 rounds from a gun. May your conscience rest in peace, Representative Heiss.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Next wishing to speak in opposition to the bill is Bruce Timmons.